Hey everybody, welcome.
We're so glad to be here.
We're so glad to be here. I'm Jenny.
And I'm Karen.
And we're co-educational directors here over at the Aromahead Institute. And it's Tuesday and we're fired up about essential oils and aromatherapy and so happy we have almost 200 people live.
Yes, that's so exciting.
It's amazing.
Your enthusiasm that's coming through is really helping us with our enthusiasm as well.
Yes. All right, so we just wanted you to pop into the chat role, where you're joining us from and what Aromahead classes you're in. It's just so fun to see who's here with us live and for you to see each other and be able to interact as a community in this way. It's just awesome.
I see so many comments where everyone is using their oils daily. Everyone is loving these live training events.
Yeah.
And some of these training events are brand new to you, and some of you have been doing this for many years. So we're excited to be able to share all kinds of information with all kinds of levels.
Yes, and we always try to tuck something in for those who are just starting out, to all the way through to if you're professionally using oils. So we try to keep all of our students and folks in mind as we put these presentations together. So thank you for joining us. And if you're watching the replay later, thanks for carving out some time and doing that too. We know your time is valuable and you are busy. So thank you for being here.
So our presentation is on dilution guidelines. And so many of you have questions on what's the right dilution.
Yeah. And there isn't just one black and white answer, so we're going to go through how to make good decisions along the way in terms of how much oil to use in the right moment for the right situation.
That's right.
Yep.
We're going to be talking about dilution guidelines, and you can go to aromahead.com/dilution.
Yes.
Put in your email address and you'll immediately see the PDF for today's dilution guidelines.
Yeah, our awesome team created a really nifty PDF that you can download. And again, like Karen was saying, aromahead.com/dilution. You can go there, you can open another tab and do it simultaneously while watching, or you can open it up later. And there's also a link we'll pin in the chat role if you're watching live. So yeah, you just download that, it'll pop up, you can print it, and it's just a little handy chart on dilution.
And this presentation will also be available for replay.
Yes.
So get your pens and paper out, take a few notes, but you'll have the PDF dilution guidelines and you'll have the replay available as well.
Yes. All right, so we are going to go through content today, and we have some robust notes here because we're packing a lot into our live session. So if you have questions as we go through, sometimes it's hard to see them as they're coming in hot. So if you save them till the end of our presentation, we're going to have a Q&A where we'll take a few questions. So we look forward to doing that.
Right, and Mina is there to help answer questions as well. So hopefully we'll get all of your questions answered as we go through the program.
Yeah.
There's a lot of information we'll be presenting that will most likely be answering your questions anyway.
Yes. All right, so we are going to, in our live event today, we are looking at dilution, but specifically we're gonna go into how blending methods can be really quick and easy and how you can make something really useful in under a minute or less. So aromatherapy can be as complex or as easy as you want it to be. And this is a quick trick to making it really easy when you can blend quickly and effectively.
We're going to touch on how to choose between a topical blend and using an inhaler blend.
Yes, and then we'll look at when to use a diffuser versus an inhaler versus a steam method.
And we'll go into a few ways of how surprisingly inhalers can affect your whole body.
Yes, and all kinds of, we find a way to tuck in information into these lives that we didn't even know we were gonna say. We just have fun hanging out with you.
So we want to remind you that on the Aromahead blog, there are so many recipes available. You can just go into the search on the top right hand and you can search, you can put in eucalyptus, you can put in orange, and all of the blogs that contain that information will pop up.
Yeah.
And there's also an amazing recipe section on aromatics.com as well.
Yes, so we're in education, both at Aromatics and over here at Aromahead, and we're just so excited to be a part of both communities, which have lots of crossover.
So as we look at the dilution guidelines, we see that there is a 1, 2, and 3% guidelines, and as many of you are already using these guidelines, this is just a quick reminder.
Yep.
So the 1% would be 5 to 6 drops that we like to use for children, maybe those who are really struggling with a health issue, maybe, who knows why, maybe you're using it on a daily basis and you choose to use a lower dilution. So we've got the 2% dilution guidelines, and these are for topical blends.
Yes.
that we're talking about. 2% is 10 to 12 drops yep. per 1 ounce of carrier, whether it's jojoba or hemp seed oil or raspberry seed oil. These are dilution guidelines for a carrier.
Yes.
So in a 2% we might use for things like a chronic condition that we definitely are using on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. And then there's the 3% dilution guidelines, which is 15 to 18 drops per 1 ounce of carrier that we might use for more of an acute situation. So something that we're using, we just banged our finger, we quickly want to put something on there to help with the pain and the mm-hmm. inflammation. Maybe we have a cold and flu that we're dealing with that just came on and we want to nip it right now.
Yes, and I know, I'm not sure how you feel or felt when you first started out using essential oils and dilution, but I know I felt pretty overwhelmed with all the math of it. So I would sit there and just write it all out, and it would just take quite a while to figure out and feel confident about the drops. But I promise you, the more you do it, it's just going to come second nature. It's like riding a bike.
I like to think about the sustainability of our oils as well, and we have a philosophy that less is better.
Yes.
So if you can use a 1% dilution or a 2% dilution, then absolutely do that instead of the 3%.
Yes, because as we know, it takes something like 50 roses to make one drop of rose essential oil. So it's always good, if you can, to use less oil for sustainability. Also, it makes your oil last longer, and it just is more affordable that way.
So what kind of blends would take a minute or less to be making?
That's a really good question. So we have all kinds of options for you.
Keep that in mind as we go through our presentation, because we will show you how there are more than one way to use to make a 1 minute blend or
yes.
less.
Yes. All right. So are we moving on to topical and inhalation?
So yes, let's look at how to choose between a topical blend and an inhaled blend.
Yes.
All right, so questions to consider, and we always consider these questions for all of our blends, are?
Yeah, so you want to consider the person you're blending for in terms of age, overall health, and then what else is going on in his or her or their life in right. terms of emotions, in terms of health. All the whole terrain needs to be considered when you're looking at whether to choose a topical application or something that involves inhalation.
Right, what is the intention of this blend? And respiratory and opening the lungs are something that we're going to be talking about today. So when we're talking about a topical blend versus an inhalation blend, inhalation, we're going to talk about a diffuser. We're going to talk about inhalers
yes.
and
steam.
And steam as
yes.
well.
And diffusers, it's indirectly. It's not as potent as an inhaler, but you're still breathing it in the air.
Okay. So a couple of guidelines. Inhalation works faster than a topical blend. When you're inhaling a blend, whether it is from your diffuser or a personal inhaler, you're going to get that into your system right away, whereas a topical blend takes a little bit longer, and sometimes you want that aspect, especially if it's a painful situation or a chronic situation. You want it to slowly kind of absorb into your skin.
Yeah, and an example of that would be a thicker body butter where you have oils and the carrier you're using is thicker, and so the oils will go into your skin a little bit more slowly, which is again exactly what you want if you're looking for bruising or you're looking to work with oils over a longer term basis.
So when would you use a diffuser versus an inhaler versus a steam? Those are kind of confusing ways and questions that we get frequently. So using a diffuser, they're all different. So you look at your specific instructions for your own diffuser. For this one, we put in tap water mm-hmm. and we might put in 10 to 15 drops of an essential oil. This diffuser will diffuse out and it will incorporate into the entire room that you are in. Mm-hmm. So it affects everybody and everything that is in that room. Mm-hmm. It's great if somebody in the household, you're talking about a family or yourself, if you're even by yourself, and there's coughing going on, there's germs floating around, a diffuser will get the entire room and help discourage all those microbes.
Very gently.
Very gently.
Yes.
So an inhaler, which is right here, a personal inhaler is something that you put your essential oils onto, and you are the only one that benefits from this. Mm-hmm. So there's some good reasons for that. Maybe it's a work atmosphere.
Mm-hmm. Maybe you're on an airplane and you don't want to overwhelm the plane with tea tree.
Right. Maybe there's people in your household or work environment who don't like various aromas, and they don't want you to be diffusing in a large area. So these are easy to tuck into your pocket.
Yes.
And not affect anybody else except for yourself. I actually, well, and you might use this diffuser in your home, and you might use an inhaler as well. Mm-hmm. So, okay, let's look at our notes here.
Yeah, we have so much information we're going over. We have notes that we can see right below the camera on a screen, and I have a printed version, so we're covered.
A steam is something that you only use one drop for, and that is when you have some hot water that you put into a bowl, and you put one drop of your blend in that. Mm-hmm. And I often will use a steam if I think, oh my goodness, I think I'm getting sick. Mm-hmm. Somebody just came and visited me, and maybe they are very sick, and I want something to immediately get in and help kill off those bad microbes.
Yes. When I was teaching high school English, I was steaming basically every night during the cold and flu season.
It's a great way to get germs to just stop in their tracks.
Yep. Even before you feel anything coming on, if you just know you've been exposed, it's just a way to boost that immune system and just keep your respiratory system healthy.
It's also really great for your skin.
Yeah, it
is. As you're steaming, and the steam helps open the pores of your skin. I like to sometimes use that just simply for my skin and put a skin nourishing essential oil in there.
And if you're thinking, what's a steam blend? Again, you can go to our aromahead.com/blog and you can type in steam blend, and directions will pop up on how to do that.
I can't say enough about the effectiveness of steaming and how supportive to the lungs this is.
And it really clears out the sinuses too, which again, those cold and flu germs can sometimes lodge in there. That's where colds can start. So if you're keeping that clear and clean, your chances of not getting sick are even greater.
So we want to make a blend for you right now that can, and you can use this blend in a diffuser, in an inhaler. You can use it in any kind of a carrier blend. And this is what makes your blending so quick and so easy. Mm-hmm. This time of year, we are dealing with people who are having colds and flus, and it's really nice to have a blend on your shelf that is ready to go in just an instant, because we are busy people.
Yes.
And you are busy people.
Yes.
You don't have time to sit down and figure out a blend every time you want to make a blend, so yes. A stock blend is fabulous.
It is fabulous, and you can take time. When you're making your stock blend, you can take a sleepy Sunday afternoon or a snowy morning, whenever is a good window for you, and you can go in depth with the GCMS reports and the safety. You can come up with a blend you love aromatically and you love therapeutically, and then you have a stock version of that blend that you can use quickly and easily.
I like that word that you use, that you love.
Yes.
So the aroma is really important to your blend. It's
yes.
important to, that's what you're gonna smell like. That's yeah. what your house is gonna smell like, and that's what you're inhaling.
Yes.
So while there's a multitude of essential oils that you can use for colds and flus, there's a couple new ones that we're going to introduce to you today. And some of you that have been using oils for a while, these might be familiar oils to you. So our recipe today is, we're going to blend in a 5 ml bottle, and we have 20 drops of tea tree, and that's an oil that almost everybody is familiar with and how great it is for decreasing infection that mm-hmm. maybe has started to set in. We love putting that in our blends when we are dealing with colds and flus. We've got 20 drops of helichrysum, but this is not a regular helichrysum. This
yes.
is helichrysum bractiferum.
And there are lots of different types of helichrysum. Again, you can read about that on our blog over at aromahead.com/blog. And the bractiferum is pretty cool.
It's pretty cool. And we'll talk a little bit about that too in just a moment.
Yes.
And then we've got the 20 drops of rhododendron. Mm. So this comes from Nepal. And we'll talk a little bit about that too as we
yes.
put our drops in.
Yes.
But I want to go back to the helichrysum bractiferum. It's much different than the helichrysum metallicum that many of you are used to using that is so great for our skin. Bractiferum can also be great for the skin, but it has some really great properties. If you're using this blend for kids, just substitute one like Rosalina or lavender or cedarwood instead of the helichrysum, because it does have a 1/8 cineol component. It's much less than eucalyptus or a ravensara, but what this offers us, the main components are, for instance, bee pinene, which, just to give you a little bit of information on this oil, it's anti-inflammatory, it's antibacterial.
Smelling
you can
so
smell
good.
It, from there. It smells really good. It's sweet. It's just a pleasant, pleasant aroma.
It's really
I
nice.
Can detect a little bit of a helichrysum in here, but not like a helichrysum italicum. So it's also very antispasmodic, and it's an antioxidant. So you can see how the helichrysum bractiferum is an excellent choice to put in your cold and flu blends. Not only is it getting rid of the microbes, but it's also helping to relax the emotions and to help us to have a good night's sleep as well.
And it smells so different. The bractiferum smells so different than the italicum. It's more florally. And it's bright, and to me the italicum is a little bit more herbaceous in some way, and it smells like sun somehow.
It does. It's, yeah. It's a beautiful, beautiful essential oil. It has bee caryophyllene in it as well, which is analgesic, and when you're fighting a cold and flu, many times an analgesic is a very welcome blend.
It just helps with that pain, soothing pain, soothing inflammation.
It's an antibacterial, antispasmodic, antiviral, so you're getting a lot of punch in
yes.
this little bottle in this in a drop of this essential oil.
Absolutely. So this is one that we've selected for the stock blend that will just again help you make quick, easy blends if you feel like you're coming down with a cold or flu.
The reason why we're making a stock blend is because it could take anywhere from 10 to 20 drops in an inhaler, and you might use 6 drops in a roller bottle blend, and you'll use 10 to 15 drops in your diffuser, depending on your diffuser. This little bottle, it's a 5 ml bottle, holds 100 drops. So I typically will blend 100 or 80 drops in here, and that will cover all of my modalities for, you know, several days. So today I am just going to put 10 drops of each in here.
Mm-hmm. So that works.
10 drops of tea tree.
We're hoping not to get colds and flus, but to just have this on hand, just in case.
In a work environment, you have a lot of people coming and going, and you never know what their health situation is. So I keep an eye out for that, and if I see that someone has been sick, I'll immediately start a diffuser blend or an inhaler.
We've both secretly gone over and made up diffuser blends that smell really good. If we have guests who are visiting who are sick, we'll just put on a nice blend that feels like it's just for aromatics, but it's not.
And it's a really great thing to even make up an inhaler for the person who might be sick, whether
yes.
it's the mailman. Say, hey, would you like to try out an inhaler that might help you out
yeah.
today? And they're always so appreciative. So because these are equal drops of each one in here, you can choose to put in 5 drops of each, 10 drops of each. And the cool thing about making a stock blend is maybe I want to put this in my diffuser, and I'm going to put 12 drops in my diffuser, but I really wish there was a conifer in here. I can maybe put 10 or 9 drops of my blend in here and then a few drops of my conifer. All right, so our third oil that we're going to put in that might be new to you is rhododendron.
Oh, and it's such a beautiful oil.
So rhododendron comes from Nepal. It's not the typical rhododendron that you see growing in your yards, but it's a wild rhododendron that grows up high in the mountains of Nepal. So it has a lot of great components too. The apinene, which we see in a chemical GCMS report, it has been highly researched, the apinene, anti-inflammatory, antibacterial, antispasmodic, antiviral, and it also helps a lot with pain.
Yes.
So it's got the bee pinene, which is also anti-inflammatory, antibacterial, antispasmodic, antioxidant, and the D-limonene, which helps to activate the white blood cells. And I'm giving you a lot of information that you can go back and listen to the recording as we're giving you a lot of information today.
So, again, we're trying to keep in mind our folks who are just starting out and our professionals, so we're putting in a little bit for everybody today.
So rhododendron also has a component, D-limonene, that's great to help activate the blood cells, but it also helps. It's a skin enhancer, a skin penetration enhancer, as 1-8-cineol is. So when you use it for a topical blend, it really helps it to absorb into the skin. So this also, it's a wonderful oil because emotionally, it is also very calming, which you need when you're not feeling so great. So two of these oils, actually tea tree does as well, work on the physical level as well as the emotional level.
We're getting a lot of questions coming in, so we see your questions and we will be answering about 5 to 10 questions in our Q&A at the end of this live presentation. One question that I'm seeing again and again is about substitution. So just a general quick statement on substitution. When we're looking to substitute oils in a blend, we wanna make sure that the oil we're selecting will support the overall intention of the blend. So for this example, if we were gonna substitute tea tree, maybe we don't have tea tree, we would look for an oil that has a very similar therapeutic properties in terms of cold and flu support or in terms of purification and that sort of thing. We would also look at a similar plant part, and we would definitely want similar chemical components in terms of an oil that is a good substitution. So those are kind of your, and you want to smell, right. You like the smell.
Right, you want to, and smell this, Jenny.
We're going to have to arm wrestle over this one too.
Mm-hmm. I love this. When you're substituting the Helichrys and Bractiferum, I hope that you'll try this oil out because it's such a fantastic oil. So you'll love to have it in your essential oil medicine cabinet. You will use it a lot. But if you don't have it and you don't plan on getting it anytime soon, I am looking for an essential oil that might have a 1-8-cineol component that, like eucalyptus, radiata, even cardamom would have that.
Be nice.
If it's a child under 5 years old or so, then I, once again, would not put the Helichrysum bractiferum in because of the 1-8-cineol. But it has a lower percentage than eucalyptus radiata or globulus.
And if we're just saying words you do not recognize and you have not taken a course from us here at Aromahead, we have a really awesome free intro course that's quite comprehensive. You might want to blitz through. It doesn't take very long and it's chocked full of really good foundational information that will help you understand some of these words.
Okay, so let's see here. Marilyn, you're ready to add.
Yes.
You just added this to your stash.
Yay, that's fantastic.
One of the things I love doing is introducing you to new essential oils, because to use the same oil over and over and over again, our body, you know, could get used to a little bit. So I like to kind of surprise the body and rotate my oils around.
Yes, and it also is a good challenge because we can all get stuck in ruts in terms of the oils we reach for the most because we love their aroma, we're familiar, we know they work, but lots of other oils have beautiful aromas and they work and they're wonderful. So mixing up what you're using also just helps challenge yourself to expand your horizons.
So Michelle, I see your question on using the tea tree on dogs, and what I would like to ask you to do is to go to our Aromahead blog, and there's
yes.
a fantastic blog.
Mina just put a link to it.
A link on how to use essential oils with pets.
Yes.
All right. So
now we would love to have your questions. So we're officially ending the presentation portion of our live event today. So again, we want to thank you if you're here live or if you're taking time to watch this replay later. Thank you so much. We love, love, love that you appreciate the content that we're creating for you because it's just so much fun for us to do. So now we're going to transition to the Q&A portion. We're going to take about 5 to 10 questions. So if you pop your questions into the chat box right now, there's a much greater chance we'll see them versus if you put them in 5 minutes ago. So re-put your question in.
So as you're doing that, to recap, to do a 1 minute blend is the answer to that is to have a stock blend ready to go. If you don't have a stock blend, inhaler blends, all you do is put your 10 to 15 drops, actually you can go up to 20 drops on these really neat organic inhalers, the cotton wicks, and you just put your oils on there. It's so quick, it's so easy. Diffusers are so quick and so easy and so effective. So if you have your stock blend ready, then the carriers are also very quick and very easy.
Yes. All right, I'm just going back through here. Okay. And you just talked about, looking, okay, yes, if you have any questions about pets, start with that blog. It's just a gold mine of information.
So to remind you, guest M-A-R-A, I just want to tell you the recipe is for 20 drops of each, but you don't have to make 20 drops of each. That is just so that you have a really nice stock blend so that you can use any modality that you want at a moment's notice. So I only put 10 drops of each in, which is 30 drops. It comes to about right here. And you can put 5 drops of each in. They're equal drops of each of these particular oils.
One last thing about animals. Guest 3257 is saying, I'm hoping there's some information about rabbits other than just dogs and cats. I know nothing about rabbits and essential oils, not a thing.
I will tell you that working with animals, if you go to the blog and read that, it gives you a way to work with no matter what animal it is, even if it says cats, dogs, or horses,
yeah.
You would use the same methods.
And once you're a student here at Aromahead, we have some behind-the-scenes exciting things going on. For example, if you're a natural living student right now, you know that we've been going through and doing a hashtag 2020 Natural Living Challenge, where we're encouraging everyone to try to finish up their class and start the new year with some really awesome essential oil blends. We're encouraging everyone to finish up by the end of this month, and we have so many students who are blitzing through their natural living class. Also, if you're an ACP student or grad, you had a special invitation to both a CBD and essential oil training and an essential oil and animal training that we did a few days ago. Those are in your accounts right now. And if you're not a student of the Natural Living or the ACP, you can sign up right now and join, or you can jump into the free intro class and you will absolutely love the content there.
So Donnie, you've got a really good question. You make water blends, and one of the things we love making too is sprays of various kinds, and you would use the same dilution guidelines, the linen sprays, the room sprays. You're not as careful keeping to the dilution guidelines because it doesn't go on to your skin. It's not topical, but we do use the same guidelines as reference. And many times we will add a dispersant or a soluble that helps bind the essential oil and either the water or the hydrosol together. Mm-hmm. So yes, I love making linen sprays, and it's something that I use every day on my linens, on my sheets.
Yes, and if you've been enjoying this presentation, our next live event is coming Thursday. So a week from, not this coming Thursday, because we're still on Tuesday. Not this Thursday, but next Thursday, the 23rd of January, we'll be going live at the same time, which is 1 p.m. Eastern Time, 11 a.m. Mountain Time, and 12 Central Time.
So, okay, let's see here. And once again, if you weren't able to watch the whole presentation, a recording is available to you after we're finished here.
Yes.
So we're so happy that you're all here late or on time or early.
Whenever you make it, whether you're here live or watching the replay or just came in, great.
So the stock blend again that we made today, and you can use any amount of drops that you want. Our recipe was 20 drops of tea tree, 20 drops of Helichrys and bractiferum, and 20 drops of rhododendron, and that gives us a good stock blend. And these oils can be found on aromatics.com, and they have great descriptions on them. You can also see the GCMS reports for each of these oils on that essential oil page.
So just off of the top of your head, Karen is one of the most talented aromatherapists I've ever met. She's also my mother, so not really. I've been going to her for years and years. Just off the top of your head, what would you use in replace of rhododendron?
So rhododendron is on there to help mitigate the microbes. It's also very calming, and it's also very lung opening. So you could substitute anything like Rosalina. You could add lavender instead. You could put
spike lavender would be nice.
Spike lavender on there is very lung opening as well. You could put another eucalyptus globulus, eucalyptus radiata.
Sorrow?
Eucalyptus dives. Sorrow is a great one. Those can be substituted for either the Helichrys and bractiferum or the rhododendron. So I'm looking for oils that help to get rid of the microbes that might be in the air, or that might be in my own system.
Did you just say lemongrass, chemotype, rhodanol?
I did not say that, but that's a great one.
That would be really great. Mm-hmm. It has a very similar chemistry to lavender, but it has that purification element to it as well.
Right.
And it's a really neat oil. We have a comment. I'm so new to essential oils. Thank you so much. This is such great information. If you're new to essential oils, you have found your home and your community. You're in the right place. So make sure you subscribe to our newsletter. We have a brand new one coming out tomorrow, Wednesday. So check your inboxes. If you haven't subscribed, hop on over to our website and aromahead.com. We would love to have you subscribe. And we've got a vibrant blog. We put up stuff all the time. And so we look forward to connecting with you throughout the week on social media, Instagram, Facebook. We're everywhere.
That's right.
Yes.
So one last question here. So guest 1870 had a really great question. Would the 5 ml bottle cause oxidation of the oil versus a smaller bottle?
Great question.
And as you know, if this were to sit on the shelf for quite some time, oxidation will occur, and that means that there's a lot of oxygen on top of the essential oil. So if you're going to make just a small amount, you can either do it per, like, just drop your drops in the diffuser and don't even have a stock bottle. When I have a stock bottle, I usually will use it up during that season. So using it for all the different modalities that we talked about. So you could use a smaller bottle for sure.
And we would just, we're going to put a label on that after we're done. We would put the date we blended, and we put the name of the blend, and then we like to put the oils on because you can get so many cold and flu blends, but you don't know what's in there.
So, and Cindy, you asked where can you order the rhododendron from, and just go to aromatics.com, look at their essential oils, or type in the box rhododendron, and you'll see all that information. And when you read the information on the rhododendron, you're gonna want it in your essential oil collection.
I know, and we say they, it's us. So Karen's been doing sourcing with Aromatics for years and years and years. She knows all these distillers personally. So again, whatever oils you use, whatever company, we still celebrate your journey, but we do happen to know a lot about the Aromatics oils.
So we appreciate you joining us, and be sure and join us next week.
Yep.
January 23rd
yep.
at 11 o'clock Eastern time, 1 o'clock. Mountain time, and
1 o'clock. So 1 o'clock Eastern time, 11 o'clock Mountain time, noon Central, 10 o'clock Pacific time.
Right.
Yes.
You're getting good at this.
I mean, it's only been a couple of years.
So enjoy making your blends up. Enjoy looking at the different oils and seeing what you can substitute as well and what your intention for this blend is. So enjoy your 1 minute blends.
Yes. And again, if you're an Aromahead student and you have questions or want to keep the conversation going, hop on into our forum and go ahead and dive in. And if you aren't yet a student, sign up for the intro class. And in the meantime, you can email team@aromahead.com if you have questions. Thank you so much for being here.
Right.